I'm Zainab Badawi, and I am chair of the Royal African Society, and it is my great pleasure to be presiding over this really extremely significant and, I'm sure, interesting and enlightening occasion. So it is a book launch, of course, for President Obasanjo's latest offering. It's a trilogy. And as befitting a man who has accomplished so much in his life, three volumes, very, very long. My watch, the first one covers his early childhood, the middle one covers his time in office, and the third one is his legacy. And it is befitting that they should be so long, because really President Obasanjo has done more in one life than many people would do. You know, he's done more, what do I want to say? He's done more in his life than most people would do in the equivalent of three lives. He's been a soldier in the Biafran War. He's been head of the armed forces in Nigeria. Of course, he headed a military government. He has been a president from 1999 until 2007. He's been a political detainee in prison, of course. Released in 1995, he was in prison under General Sani Abacha. And he's also been a real member of the kind of African elders on the continent, you know, the troubleshooters. He's done a lot with where I was born, the Sudan, before the two Sudans broke up. He, of course, even as a young man, served in that UN peacekeeping mission in the DRC in the Congo, as it was then. So really, he's a man of tremendous breadth of experience. And of course, Mr. President, you have really stirred things up with your comments in Nairobi, backing somebody. This is not a man who really shirks or shies away from saying what he thinks. So, of course, I'm sure this is one thing you're all going to be developing with him, and obviously Richard Dowden will too, as to why he has decided now to back General Buhari in the elections, a man actually who stood against you in one of the elections, and he did, didn't
one,
he? Yeah.
Is it one or two?
Three. He ran for president three times, and on one of those occasions it was against you. And then, of course, the current president, good luck, Jonathan, was your protege, whom you backed very much to become vice president and to take over from Yar Adua. So now you've switched sides, and no doubt you're going to be explaining to us why you have. I'm going to be conducting the questions and answer, the points that you'll be raising. But first of all, my wonderful director, Richard Dowden at the Royal African Society, an old Africa hand, is going to be in conversation with President Obasanjo first. So, Richard, over to you.
Thank you very much, Zainab. Congratulations on writing this, I say book, but three volumes. Drop it on your toe and you'll do yourself a real damage. More than 1,000 pages, and it's As I began to read it, I realized, I mean, this is the history of Nigeria. Your adult life has spanned Nigeria's life as an independent country. You know the history. You are the history of so much of it. The longest serving president and the only president to complete two terms and step down. I was just looking back, out of the 15 presidencies that Nigeria's had, four resigned or were replaced constitutionally, only four. And one of those was our present queen, quite early on. So completing your term and stepping down is quite an achievement in Nigeria. The rest were either the victims of coups or died. So I want to ask you, what forged you? What made you who you are? I get the impression reading your book of very strong, very strict, very determined parents, very strong sense of religion, of right and wrong. Was that a typical Nigerian upbringing in the 1930s?
Well, thank you very much, Richard. I think as I try to bring out in this book, I was born by illiterate parents. My father, my mother never went to school. We lived in a village. And the next community or the next settlement or the next village is about the limit of our world, so to say. But maybe because what we needed in the village were very few. Although, comparatively, if you look at it at time and now, we were very poor, but we were not in want. And our parents gave us the best within the limit of their resources. The best within the limit of their resources. And if you read my early life, my mother never indulged me or indulged my sister who came after me. But she loved us and she showed love. My father never indulged me, except I love to eat with my father. Because if there are 4 pieces of meat in the plate, my father will make sure that I eat 2. With my mother, if there are 4 pieces of meat in the plate, she will give me half. And that half, I must not eat. I must hold it tight in my left hand, and I must not eat it until I finish eating the food. Otherwise, I will be regarded as greedy, and I will be punished for it. And then, of course, we had a Baptist church in our in our village. And the Baptists are more or less Puritans, more or less. They don't drink alcohol, or they are not supposed to drink alcohol. They are not even supposed to smoke. So it is a mixture of what I would call traditional values and the culture of our place and our time, and that mixed rightly, I believe, with religious upbringing that made my early life.
I get a very strong sense of that, that the Baptist church and the local chiefs and the traditional power structure. I don't think you even mentioned it, and I didn't get any sense of a British rule there at all. And I wondered, it made me wonder, what was the impact of 50 years of imperial British rule? I mean, apart from its shape and English becoming the language of communication, would Nigeria be any different at all if it had never been taken over by Britain? Is it so much itself that that colonial impact was almost nil in Nigeria?
Well, for me, as I was growing up, the British rule in Nigeria did not really affect or impact on me directly.
Were you typical in that way, do you think?
I will say I was typical in that way. Maybe because I was born and bred up in a village where The only time that we go out of the village is on a market day, whether I take products from my father's farm to sell in the market, or something that my mother had to sell. And in that, well, the only thing that you will see, we had a railway station not too far. Well, I don't know whether we can regard that as impact of military, of British rule or not. Well, we know that if there was anything wrong in our village, we would get the police coming from the district headquarters, which is about 5-6 miles from the village. Well, that is what we will see of government. Oh yes, there's another one. I don't know whether that is British. The sanitary inspectors. and I hated them. I hated them because they would come. You know, we have the port of water normally behind the entrance door to the main building. Now, when these sanitary inspectors came, now they will go into that pot of water, and if you don't cover your pot of water, you will have mosquito larvae inside, and then my mother will be fined. And it's that fine that made me to hate sanitary inspectors, right? Because here was a poor woman, what did he make and all that. And then the water that we drink, and you come and you start looking into it, and you say, oh yes, there are things here, and then you, I didn't like them. But I think those are the...
That's the limit of...
Of what I know of government, or okay. We had a road, and maybe once or twice a month, we will have a lorry coming to collect people for the market or something, but. We really didn't. Our world was encapsulated within the walls of rurality. Shall I put it that way? There's nothing we wanted in the city. We have our water. We went to work. The families are nicely knit together, and the community is a community that is...
They manage themselves.
They manage themselves, and are happy.
You join the army, and you get sent for training in Britain, and then rise up through the ranks, and then, jumping forward, you've fought in the Civil War, and you took the surrender of Biafra. Could that war have been avoided? And would it have been better if Biafra had split away? What would Nigeria look like if they'd won their independence from Nigeria?
Richard, those are... We can only speculate about what it would have been if Biafra broke away permanently. But for me, as a Nigerian, I'm very happy. I was very happy, and I'm very happy today, and I will be very happy until I die that Biafra did not break away permanently. As I always say to Nigerians, I believe that all of us in Nigeria, we are better off because Nigeria remained a united, viable country. I say this to those, because there are still those who believe that Nigerian unity is a mistake, that Lord Lugard made the greatest mistake of his life by bringing the Southern Protectorate and the Northern Protectorate together. I am not one of those who felt that way. I feel that God doesn't make a mistake. And if God used Lord Lugard to bring Nigeria together, that was what God wished for Nigeria and the people of Nigeria. And it meant this, that we as Nigerians have responsibility for ourselves. But we must realize that we also have responsibility beyond ourselves by virtue of the fact that Nigeria is the largest country in Africa, and by virtue of the fact that Nigeria is the largest black race in the world. Now, that imposes certain amount of responsibility on us. And that is one of the reasons why we must constantly remind ourselves as Nigerians that we are not for ourselves alone. So when we do what we should not do, we shouldn't blame it on anybody. As you will see in that book, I didn't blame the British for what we are not doing well. After how many years? We have celebrated 50 years of independence. Who are we blaming? Or why should we be blaming? Now, so you ask, will Nigeria have been better off? I don't think so. Maybe if Biafra had gone on between the borders of Nigeria and borders of Biafra, we will have military men permanently manning the borders. Well, we don't have that now. And I remember, and I brought that in the book, when in 1998, 99, I was going around campaigning to be elected president of Nigeria. I went to Kano, and one of the important, come from one important family of Dantata, Sanusi Dantata, I went to him at about 10 p.m. to solicit his support. And Sanusi Dantata looked at me and said, "Yeah, you want to be president of Nigeria?" I said, "Yes, I've been convinced that I should be." He said, "Then you have to convince me that I will not need to take passport or to take a visa to go to Lagos or to take a visa to go to Port Harcourt." I said, "Sir, it is because I don't want to take a visa to come to Kano that I have accepted to be the president of Nigeria." He said, "In that case, I vote for you." You said, could the war have been avoided? I believe so. Not on the basis of Aburi agreement, because Aburi agreement definitely was not in favor, or was not suitable for a united Nigeria. But maybe if the two military leaders then, Gawan and Emeka Ojukwu, have exercised a little bit of caution, maybe. Neither of them had expressed remorse for what had happened. I was closer to Emeka Ojukwu than I was to Gawan, because Emeka Ojukwu and I served in the 5th Battalion together, and our rooms were next door to each other. And at the end of the war, of course, I know that you have a blow. The first blow was the coup. And in law of physics, they say action and reactions are equal and opposite. Now, in human interaction, actions and reactions are opposite, but they are not equal. Now, if you give me a blow and I have opportunity, I will give you two. Now, if you give me three, if I have opportunity, I will want to knock you down and stand on you. Now, so action and reaction in human interaction is opposite. It may be opposite, but it may not be equal. And we had that situation where we had action, the coup of 15th of January 1966, and then reaction, which came in July, and then reaction to reaction, which was the secession, and then reaction to reaction to reaction, which was the Civil War launched. And you can see the escalation, how it goes from one step to another. Now, but I believe we should thank God that it did not lead to permanent division of Nigeria. I am happy for that. Yeah. And I believe that we must learn the right lessons, as I try to even bring out in my book on the Civil War and also in this book.
Okay. To come up to date, you're very critical of the two previous presidents. President Yadua, you describe as, and I quote, tardy, shoddy, selfish, unpatriotic, and reckless. And you describe his presidency as the looting of Nigeria. These are harsh words. On President Goodluck Jonathan, you refer to his inability to deal with Boko Haram, and you speak of his ineptitude, ineffectiveness, inefficiency, carelessness, callousness, insensitivity, cluelessness, and selfishness. These are very tough words.
Richard.
They're your words, not mine.
A very bad situation needs a strong medicine to deal with it. We normally talk of a disease. When I was growing up in the village. And when you have a disease, you need a strong concoction to deal with it. When you hope and you work, not just for the goodness, but for the greatness of a country, and you have spilled your blood. I was wounded in the Civil War. For that country, and you have been imprisoned unduly for that country, and then you see people frittering away all the goodwill, all that can make that country great and good. And you know, you see, because for me, it's not just an armchair critic. I've gone through it. I know what can be done. I know what is not being done. And I go around the world and they say, well, Nigeria is not at the table. And if Nigeria is not at the table, what does Africa do? I say, Then you expect me to come back home and say, hey, well done, champ. I've gone around the world and they say, while you are on watch, during your watch for Nigeria, Nigeria is not at the table and you are doing well. Of course, that will not be what you will expect me to do. And not only that, well, these are two people. Take Umaru Yar'Adua. His slogan during his campaign is continuity. I don't expect him to continue everything my administration has done in every detail. But look at what we have done and see what you can continue. And if you cannot continue, why you cannot continue? I always tell people in Nigeria, president before me, people before me, people after me, that you have no cause to fail. Because the president of Nigeria can call any Nigerian anywhere in the world for advice, or anybody anywhere in the world for advice, guidance, information, what have you. Let me give you an example. When I took over as president of Nigeria, one of the things I wanted to do is diversify the economy. And I wanted to pay attention, apart from agriculture, I wanted to pay attention to what they call solid mineral. That's minerals other than oil and gas. So I went to a friend of mine in London, in New York, who's made his fortune from solid mineral. And I said, friend, look, I want you to come to Nigeria. He said, what for? I said, for solid mineral. He said, you are joking. A friend of mine, I'm in government, I'm head of government, and I want him to come. He said, you are joking. I said, what do you mean by that I'm joking? He said, look, those of us who sit in New York, or in Frankfurt, or in London, and take decision to invest in solid mineral or whatever, we have more than 50% assurance that our investment will yield something. I said, but we have solid minerals in Nigeria, you will yield something. So wait, where is your law? And we had no law. So where is your regulation? And we had no regulation. He said, where is your survey to give us an idea of what mineral you have and where? And we had nothing like that. So then I turned to him, I said, okay, now, you see, I was joking. Now I don't want to joke. I want to be serious. So what do I do? He said, first of all, you must have a law. I said, where do I go? He said, go to the World Bank and tell them, well, this is what you need. They will give you the draft of a law. You can, and that's what I did. I went to the World Bank. I said, no, okay, now I want to pursue investment in solid mineral, and the rest of them.
Okay. Nigeria is linked in many people's minds with the word corruption, and it has been a scourge in Nigeria and Africa generally. You appointed Malam Nuhu Ribadu as the anti-corruption guy, and you call him in the book courageous and intrepid, and you say you fully backed him. But a WikiLeak dated the 31st of December 2007 reveals a conversation between Mr. Rabadu and Robin Saunders, who was then the US ambassador to Nigeria. She says that Rabadu told her that, and I quote, "You really knew how to play the game. Although he, that's you, created the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission and understood its importance internationally for him, Rabadu explained that by far, even more than in the Abacha days where he was the sole thief, corruption in Obasanjo's 8 years was far worse because everyone stole. No doubt he did as well. However, he added, Obasanjo was a political machine. He knew how to play the game for the international community and cover his tracks, and for good or bad, he got it as regards to what the role of the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission role was and should be." What do you say to that?
Who said that?
This is Ambassador Saunders, Robin Saunders.
Who said that?
Reporting on what Rabadu said about you. I'm surprised nobody's...
No, nobody has ever pointed that to me.
Oh, okay.
Will also see the report published in my book of what Rabadu, what his total investigation on me portrayed.
Okay. Then he doesn't say this. He doesn't.
Not at all.
But he seemed to have said this to the American ambassador.
Well, if I would want to, I will not want to believe this. But if it is said by Rabadu, I will be surprised. If it's said by the ambassador, I will not be surprised. Yes.
It's filtered throughout. It's
now,
the ambassador.
And I'm sure that if Rabadu sees this, he will, because it will be contradictory, completely contradictory to his report, which I publish here. And the first thing that Rabadu did was he came here. He brought Metropolitan Police. And they came to me and said, "Look, sir, we are happy that you now allow us, as they allow you to do what you said, to investigate them freely." He said, "Before you came, when we are investigating and it's going too far, they will say, well, stop. It's going too far, stop it." But nobody will say I ever stop him from investigating anybody or investigating me. And if that is the case, Rabadu couldn't have said that. But if I have said it, then it will be different from the report, in which case it will be fraudulent of him. Now, if the ambassador has said it, well, I know that ambassadors lie for their country.
Okay. I thought I should raise it. I pass back to Zainab.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you, Richard. Thank you, Mr. President. So, so you heard it all there. Early village life, the enforced near vegetarianism almost imposed by your mother on you, and the tragedy, upheaval of the Biafran War, and what you think of your political successors, and of course the WikiLeaks thing. So we've got about 45 minutes now, Mr. President. Are you all right? This is a non-stop here to get some questions or comments from the floor. Ooh, I can see 1, 2, 3, 4. 9, 10. Okay, I'll take 3 at a time. Is that all right? Maybe 2 or 3 at a time, if we could do that.
Yes.
Okay, and I can see all these male hands. I'm going to abuse my position as a female chair, and I'm going to ask the lady there in the spectacles to go first, and then the lady behind her.
I'm not surprised that you point at the lady first.
Yes, yes. I like my gender balance.
That's what Mr. Gender discrimination.
Gender discrimination.
Gender nepotism.
Absolutely. I'm all for it. I say nothing in my defense. Please.
Thank you. Excellent.
wait for the microphone, I should say. Give your name and organisation if relevant, and keep them quick, please.
Okay. My name is Zainab Osman.
Good name.
Yes, for namesake. Doctoral candidate in international development at the University of Oxford.
Is it on?
I can't hear you.
Yeah, we can't hear. Just hold it close, very close, maybe.
Zainab Usman, doctoral candidate in international development at the University of Oxford. Thank you, Your Excellency. It's always a pleasure hearing you speak and your views about Nigeria and a number of current issues. My question is on the continuity of your legacy during your time as president between 1999 and 2007. As you mentioned, it was this legacy was and is something very important to you. And to that effect, one would argue that to ensure this continuity, you could have tried to groom your deputy, for instance, Atiku Abubakar, who was...
Okay. All right. Is that the question? But quick, please. You know, because there are a lot of people who want to
Absolutely.
Speak.
Let me just round up the question. Who was a member of the economic management team?
Yeah.
To ensure that continuity.
Okay.
What was the issue that you had with him?
Okay, all right.
Thank you.
But listen, in the interest of democracy, you can see all the hands. I really want people to speak very, very briefly. Be kind to your fellow members of the audience. Where's the microphone? Microphone, is there only one microphone? Is there a microphone there? There's only one. Okay, could you give the microphone to people at the back? Okay, next one, quickly, please.
Hi, I'm Sally Hayden from Vice News. I was just wondering, in terms of obviously you have experience both in the army and with the government, and one of the things that's come out recently is that members of the army have said that politicians have been meddling in their affairs. I was just wondering, could you say something about the relationship between the government and the army and okay. whether you think it's deteriorating?
Currently now, I'll tell you. Yeah. Okay, one more. Let's go that side.
Why
Shushan.
Don't you tell me that shit that you're
Okay. The relationship between the government and the army
okay.
currently, is that what you're saying, in this okay. current situation? Yeah. One more and then we'll give you an answer, yeah. Briefly.
Okay. Habibu Yaya Bapa, African Leadership Center at King's College. My question, sir, is you appear to be more concerned about the concerns of your friends outside Nigeria about Nigeria. And so most of the time you react because your friends outside Nigeria are concerned about what is happening in the country. Is that impression that I have correct about you? You don't listen to the cries from within
right.
so much that...
Okay, all right. So you're more concerned about external opinion than you are people internally, than the one about the relationship between the government and the army, and then why you didn't back Abu Bakr as your... groomed him as your successor. So briefly, if you would, Mr. President, which one do you want to take first?
The last one I don't quite understand, that I'm more concerned about outside than about inside.
Opinion, what people outside of Nigeria think about Nigeria than what Nigerians living inside think about Nigeria.
No, I don't know. If I have given you that impression, then I'm wrong. No. I believe as Nigerians, I worry about what Nigerians internally say about Nigeria, because they are not only saying, they are feeling. They are not only saying, they are feeling. They are subject and object of what is good and bad in Nigeria. Mm-hmm. So if I have given you that impression, I'm sorry, that's not what I want to give. For me, I count, I take what happens in Nigeria as seriously, or what comments Nigerians make. Well, there are certain things about Nigerians. As I always say, there are
okay.
a number of reasons why people in Nigeria criticize. Some criticize genuinely. And when you look at their criticism, it's meaningful. Mm-hmm. Maybe because they are not adequately informed. Mm. Out of ignorance or out of lack of knowledge or what is going on. For instance, people have been saying, look, I should comment on the postponement. And I said, I refrained to comment on the postponement because when the postponement of the election took place, I was in Munich, in Germany. Now, I want to get home and be able to say, look, what has happened here? What is this? Then I will be making statement from informed position. Mm. Now, of course, if there are also those people who, out of mischief, just want to criticize. And they are, of course, professional critics. That's what they do. And there's nothing you can do to please them. I always say of them that if I lie on the road, across the road, for a vehicle to go over me for the sake of Nigeria, such people will say, stupid man, why did he lie just across? He should lie along the road so that the vehicle will go from toe to head.
So the second, yeah, because there's so many hands. Yeah.
Then there are those, but there are so many hands.
Okay, so many, yeah, there are so many hands. Briefly, if you would answer, government and army.
Relationship between government and the army. Mm. Now, in a democracy, government is the head of the army. By that I mean the army serves government and the army obeys government. Now, if a situation arises where the government will now say, the army says it's not ready to maintain law and order, it's not ready to perform its function, it's not ready to carry out its roles. Now, I do not know. Maybe something have changed since I was in the army or since I was head of government. Now, the other point, continuity of legacy. No, there's nobody that can say, yes, I have done this and my successor government will continue. You can never be sure. Now, and you may wish it, you can never be sure it will happen. Now, when I was a military head of state, one of the things that my successor had done that I believe is good for Nigeria was what we call National Youth Corps. I believe it's a wonderful thing. And I even inscribed it in our constitution. That's as much as I thought it's important. My successor didn't put it in, make it only a law. So you cannot be too sure, even if it's your son, and you hand over to him.
Okay. All right.
Never be too sure.
So but listen. Oh my God. Okay. Now, look at all these hands.
He asked a good question.
He did. We'll be here all night. Yeah.
No. He asked a good question, but he spoiled it at the end. I said, why not Atiku? What issue do you have with him?
That was Zainab Osman. Yeah. Okay.
Zainab.
Yeah.
I have no personal issue with Atiku, but if I then, with what I know about Atiku, which you can read in my book.
Okay, read the book. Are you a member of his family?
I know about Atiku, if I have put Atiku forward, God will not have forgiven me.
Okay. Okay. Listen. I have to really be strict with everybody now. Just 1 minute, and it doesn't have to be a question. It can also be a comment, and then we can also have just a brief response. Carl Ziegler, briefly, everybody, yeah.
Yeah, thank you. I was honored, Mr. President. You may remember, in 77, we placed a $1.4 billion loan when the oil price was going up and things looked promising. The oil price is not looking so good today. What do you think will be the outcome in terms of the election, and who do you think will win the election?
Okay, all right, thank you. Can you hand the microphone? Yep. Just hand it to anybody so that we keep going.
My name is Kamalafe Omotsunde from the African-Hungarian Union.
Briefly.
Yes, my question is, we Nigerians in diaspora, we try to imagine how can we take part in the new government. I don't know who's going to be the next president of Nigeria, but how can we be part of that new development coming to Nigeria? That's my question.
Thank you. Okay. Who's got the microphone? Yep.
Mr. President.
Look, we're going to get through everybody, I hope.
It's Kunle Onabolu.
Yeah.
Mr. President, you've had the opportunity to see things from a very bird's eye view, having been at the pinnacle of Nigeria. And you've had a lot of experience over the many years to see how Nigeria has changed and developed. Clearly, for many people, it's retrogressed in a lot of ways, and we're not anywhere near where we should be. If you put on your vision of an understanding and look to the future, what would you say to those of us coming behind?
Okay.
Is it hope?
What would he say?
What would you say to us? How would you see the future of Nigeria?
Okay,
because we've had too many ups and downs. Promises that look good, and then things going very, very sour.
All right, let's take those three then. Who's going to win the election? You could answer that very quickly for us. How the diaspora can be involved in the development of the continent, and then also briefly how you see the future.
If I can predict who will win the election, then it will not even be right for me to tell it here publicly.
That's that then, with that one, next one, yeah?
That I cannot do.
Okay.
But you do talk about loan in 1977, the jumbo loan.
Jumbo, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Which we have repaid.
Thank the Lord.
Which we have repaid. And then you say, what is the position now? Quite honestly, my own belief is that if we can stop the leakage, even at $50 per barrel, we can manage our economy.
Mm-hmm. All right, I'll get the microphone to you. Okay, so then how the diaspora can engage.
I think I've said this before about this, diaspora. I said it out there.
Yeah.
But let me say it again.
Just briefly then.
Briefly. In 1999, after my election, I went to the United Nations and I met Nigerians in diaspora. And I said, and the question is, how do we make use of you here? And I said, look, in this day and age of e-this, e-that, you don't even need to physically be present. We can make use of your talent, your experience, your knowledge, and then we form what we call NIDO, Nigeria in Diaspora Organization. Mm-hmm. And they have been doing wonderfully.
A lot of good things, yeah.
Okay,
well. I'm going to tell you what. You know the final question about how you see the future of Nigeria. Yeah. Let's take that one at the very end as your final answer, okay? I promise we'll come to it. Will be your final point. Don't you think? The future?
You are the boss.
Yeah, thank you. I'll be your campaign manager, if you like. Okay. Yes, next, and then the microphone to the front. You need a microphone.
Good evening, Mr. President. Yep. Good evening, everybody. My name is Priscilla, Ben Television. I actually have two questions.
No, just one. Oh. I'm sorry. There are so many people.
Okay.
Really,
My dear sister, don't be greedy.
Yeah, don't be greedy. Just one. Just one, everybody.
Okay.
Yeah. Because there are lots of people.
That's fine. I'll ask the one. You know, you've told us about your experience with Nigeria. You've shed blood for Nigeria. You've gone through a lot, and you've done so much for the good of the country. However, when the book came out, and recently some of your utterances, some have said that you're overheating the polity. What would you say to that? Okay. Would you agree with that, or would you
Thank
say
you.
That you're not?
Microphone in the front here, and then who's got it in the back? While it's coming to you, we'll take somebody else. Who's got the microphone? There. Stand briefly.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Dr. Olugumi Ajayi, my question is regarding the development of local government in Nigeria. As we know, Nigeria is, by 2050, we've become one of the largest economies, but the development is not filtering down to local government. So what did you do? What was your track record when you were president as far as energizing local economies and bringing about sustainable development in local government? And what advice would you give to the new government? Because if we're going to have sustainable development in Nigeria, we've got to invest in developing local government and developing local economies.
Do you honestly think he can answer that in a minute or so? Okay, he can try. One more and then I'll come back to you.
Mr. President, you have identified that one of the problems of Africa is poor leadership. What you describe as unprepared leadership and accidental leadership. If that is the case, what role would the first presidential library being built in Africa by you help in making sure that the future leadership of Africa, because you tower up in your Nigeria, an African leader, what role will that in preparing future leadership?
Okay, thank you. So, all right, the first one, are you overheating the politics, President Obasanjo? I mean, your book has been banned in Nigeria pending this libel action by an aide of President Jonathan. Are you stirring things up too much?
Well, my dear sister, I don't understand what you mean by overheating. Because I've never made fire. I've never made fire to overheat anything.
Do you want to answer?
But if, look, when things are going bad, and you know that things are going bad, and you cannot speak out, you are an accomplice. Mm. And you have nowhere. You are an accomplice. And what am I afraid of? That I cannot speak my mind. If you prove that I'm wrong, I'll be the first to apologize. Now, somebody said here now that, well, the impression he got with this. I said, well, look, if that is the impression, then that will go from what I have said, I'm wrong. And that's not what is intended. I am sorry. I will be the first. But how can things be going wrong? Look, are you a Nigerian? Oh, God.
Okay.
I think even what where we are today, shouldn't people be talking?
Okay. How do you rejuvenate local economies? That's where it's going to happen.
Economy.
Just like one quick word of advice.
You talk about, look, when I was military head of state, one of the things that I did, which endures till today, was to reform local government and make local government a third tier of government. We have federal, state, and local. And the reason for that is for local government to be able to be an engine of development by itself. Now, what happened was we wanted local government to be a government in its own right, have Department of Education, Department of Forestry, Department of Agriculture. But it was so bastardized that local governments really are not worthy. They are not worth what they are supposed to be. So if any day local government, that is where the government that is nearest to the people. The government where people can say, look, this is my government.
You're agreeing with
okay.
That.
All right.
Presidential library.
Yeah.
Leadership skills.
Yeah, my brother who talk about presidential library knows a little bit about it.
Tell us what you hope to achieve with your presidential library, just in a couple of sentences.
Presidential library is something. One of the things that I put my attention to now, and it's, as he said, is the first of its kind, really, in Africa, and maybe the first of its kind, seriously, out of the United States of America, where they have developed the culture and the tradition of presidential library. Now, one of the things, or one of the key
or the engine room of our presidential library is what we call Center for Human Security. And the Center for Human Security, as you understand, human security covers a lot. And one of the things that that center is taking care of is leadership.
Okay. Did you visit the Bush and Clinton libraries while you were setting yours up? Oh.
Actually, the Ralph Applebaum and Associate, who were consultant to Clinton.
Oh, you used him?
Were recommended by Clinton.
Really? I could have done it for you. some at the back. Just give the microphones in. If everybody asks something very quickly, I can get you in the next 20 minutes, if you're very quick.
Thank you. I'm Monica Alabi, and I'm from the health sector. There's not been much talk about the key outcomes for health in Nigeria. And I think during your time, there were lots of advances with telecommunications. Health. But the health outcomes for Nigeria have been very appalling in terms of cancer survival. And all the indicators are really poor. So my question is, what did you do during your time? And what's your hope for the future for health? Because we're in a bad place.
Well, we've got a future one, which we're going to save up for the end. So maybe we can incorporate the outlook for the health sector in your final comment, OK? OK, so we can take three more now. Yep.
I think this is on. Hi, Lawrence Diamond. I'm a recent graduate at SOAS. There was a committee, a report published last week by a committee in the UK Parliament that said Britain was now failing to meet its obligations as a middle power. Would you like to see the British government doing more to combat or to assist the Nigerian government in combating the insurgency in the north?
OK, thank you. I'll tell you, don't worry. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Caro. I'm a business intelligence professional. Sir, you served in the army, and recently the army in Nigeria has been put into disrepute, especially with the half-truths that they've been telling about girls being abducted and them rescuing the girls, about ceasefire and all that. And especially recently with the certificate issue of General Buhari. Do you think it's like the army now recruits like sort of semi-illiterate? Do you agree with that? Can you defend
the
army?
What was the question?
About the army, the Nigerian army being put into disrepute recently.
About the Nigerian army being
semi-illiterate.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so we'll take a couple more at the back and then I'll come forward. Yeah. But you're the photographer. You can't ask a question.
Hello. I'm Chris. I'm Professor Chris Imafidon. I supervise PhD students and masters in Cambridge. Sir, because you occupy a very unique position of having been a military leader combined with being a civilian leader, what role do you think education, not just certification, I mean, what happens within the four walls of a classroom, but education that continues with mass media play in really developing a true leader? Because I think we are tired of accidental leaders, as you put it.
Okay, let's take that one first then. Well, the role of education, including through the media, in what? In developing new leaders.
True leaders.
So true leaders, educate. You got the gist of it.
Yeah. Well.
Okay, and then I'll give you the other two. Uh-huh.
Yeah. Let me deal with. My brother, who said he was asking the question, if the Nigerian army are made up of
semi-literate. Yeah. Okay. Briefly.
Let me deal with that. I think I answer the part of that question there. Now, if. And let me answer it the way I answered it there. When I joined the army, almost in mid-1950s, I needed to have a Cambridge certificate or West African school certificate, whatever, or GCE, in a minimum of six subjects to be able to join the army. And I don't know of anybody who was an officer at that time that didn't have similar certificate. Mm-hmm. Buhari joined the army about 4 years after me. And if I needed such a certificate to be admitted into the army, I don't know how he could have avoided such a certificate. But even assuming that he avoided that certificate, assuming, Buhari went through a military academy. He went through what we call staff college, which would be a minimum equivalent of a first degree. He went through what in America they call war college, where they have given him an equivalent of master's degree. And our constitution or electoral law requires school certificate. And rather than us to campaign and debate on real issues, we then degenerated to trivialities. Now, because this is important, they said that somebody said it. We know ourselves. I had a record in my secondary school days and in my university days that nobody of my, no peer of mine has been able to beat. So if you now say I am an illiterate, I am not educated, I will say, read my book.
Okay. And then just briefly you had the question from the young man about whether you want the British government to help Nigeria tackle Boko Haram. And then the one about education and leadership.
Now,
briefly.
I said it earlier. Nigeria fought a civil war for 3 years. And we concluded that war by uniting our country. The slogan was no victor, no vanquished. And we did it. Within 10 years of that end of that war, Alex Ekweme, who was on the other side, on the Biafra side, became the number two person after an election in Nigeria. There's no country that has achieved such a feat. No country. That you have a civil war and somebody who raised and who rose against the national integrity. The war ended in 1970. By 1979, Alex Ekweme became the vice president of Nigeria. We did that on our own. The war, the reconciliation, the rebuilding, the rehabilitation, all by ourselves. I think we deserve an applause.
Okay. Just the one about the British government, maybe, yeah.
Yeah.
Briefly. No, would you like help the British?
We want to remain and then continue to enjoy the relationship between the Nigerian army and the British army. I had my military training here, and I went to the Royal College of Defence Studies here in London for 1 year. I went to Staff College in India. We maintain all this.
But you got all that early discipline from your mother, by the sounds of it. She put the soldier into you, didn't she? Mr. President, I'm going to... Because we've only... I know she did. I know she did. She's the one who gave you backbone. So we are very talented at the Royal African Society, but 15 minutes is only 15 minutes. Mr. President, I don't know whether you think this would be useful, which is for you just to take a pause, because you've been speaking a lot, and to just hear what people are saying, even if you don't have time to answer all of the questions. How do you think that sounds to you guys? So you can actually make your question more of a comment so that Mr. President and his staff can hear the kind of preoccupations that you have. Would that be useful? And I'm sure there's a website if you really feel you want an answer. So on that basis, microphones, just hand the microphones to everybody and a minute each, and then the last few minutes of Mr. President at the end. If there's something you really want to answer, then do. Let's do it that way, because I don't want to disappoint anybody, because I'm a nice person.
Just a very quick statement slash question. Mr. President, we're all very pleased to have you here. I think the key question for most of us is, if, in any case, there is a switch in government to APC, are you concerned that Boko Haram gets solved?
If there is a switch
in power, right? If Boko Haram's issues in the North gets solved, do you think we're going to see men rise again in the Delta? Because the feeling is, the South-South is having the presidency for the first time, and the Southwest/North are conspiring to take power away.
Okay.
So do you think all of this ethnic...
We'll try and answer that.
That's very important.
Okay,
all right. This.
Okay.
It's very, very
okay,
important.
Okay, answer that, yeah, fine.
My dear brother, the day that because an Isoko man becomes president of Nigeria and he contests election for a second term, and he fails, if he fails, then Nigeria will have no peace. Then that day, may God never make it to come.
Amen.
Look, what are you talking about? Now, is it, please, is it the militants in this Delta that put Jonathan there?
No.
Now, what is the population of the militants? Now, don't let us bring this type of nonsense about our country. Now, anybody must be free to contest and win or lose. And then you tell me because, now when I was contesting, Yoruba didn't come out and say if Obasanjo doesn't win, then the hell will let loose. In any case, Yoruba didn't even vote for me.
Thank you. Good point. I think, yeah, you made a good point. It's true. Okay.
Yeah,
just very briefly.
Okay. My name is Joy Ukebu. I am here today. I've listened to what you've said, and I'm glad I'm making comments.
Briefly.
The comment I'm making is that listening to you and what you've said previously in your... And I wonder whether you have love for the Nigeria you said you ruled. If so, why do you support Buhari, who in 1983 destroyed what we had that led to the corruption today? I came here in 83 planning to go back to Nigeria, to study and go back to Nigeria. The queue came. And you and Buhari, you've been there before and you come here today. And we do have young people of Nigeria who can actually rule Nigeria as well. But why do we have to have, the same people ruling us?
All right. Don't worry. We'll move
to
the next person. You're all going to speak. Don't worry, because you're not going to get an answer necessarily.
My question is very simple. It was reported in the media that you are supporting General Buhari. Now you are in PDP and you are supporting the candidate of the opposition party. Is that not a serious offense in terms of discipline?
All right, thank
What's
you.
Your comments about
Put
that?
The microphone forward.
Your Excellency.
Who's got
sir?
One there? I'm just bringing the microphones forward. Yeah.
Your Excellency, my name is Prince Adeyemo from Ibadan. Now, I'm speaking as somebody who has been following your career from, way back. But from 1998, when the PDP party was formed, I, as a founding member of the party, I've been following your career. And
got that bit.
Well, my question quickly, I wanted to go to that question. My question is, according to what you wrote in that book about the failings of the late President Umaru Yar'Adua and the present president, good luck, Jonathan.
Yeah.
Now, my question is, what happened to our golden boy, Donald Duke? Why? What happened?
Okay, all right. Next. Thank you. Okay.
Yep. Thank you.
Thanks for coming here, Mr. President. My name is Bodhi Asabi. I'm from the Project Management and Infrastructure Project Management. I've been following you for a while now, Mr. President, and you've been in the Army, and I know how you dealt with the OD situation when there was a militant, the militant issue there in the South, when they rose up. And when Boko Haram was rising up, you're also aware they were also rising up under your leadership, under your watch. If you're the president today, how would you deal with the Boko Haram?
Okay,
would
thank you.
Allowed to be roaming around, or would
thank you
settle the issue?
Okay. Yeah, I can't take more hands going up. Listen, we've got 10 minutes. Briefly, yeah? You can choose what you want to answer. I'm just trying to take... I promise this lady, you're going to burst a blood vessel if I don't give you... Okay. Microphone. Okay. Who's got the microphone? Who's got the microphone?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Yes. My name is...
Just a minute. We will come to you. We will come to you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And thank you.
I can't. Yeah, I can't.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Yeah, yeah.
My name is Awal Musa Arab Sanjani. I'm from Nigeria. Mr. President, sir, in view of the looting, impunity, and the violence that is going on in this country, and given your love for the country, won't it be better for you to begin to dialogue and convince people so that, you know, we resolve this political, you know, crisis in a peaceful manner rather than this kind of, you know, situation that we have at hand? What, you know, from the other hand, people are threatening, you know, that if their candidate did not win, they are going to balkanize the country. Then do you think you have still a role to play in terms of resolving this problem amicably?
That's good. You have a role to play in resolving. This lady here, because, yeah, just say it, please, yeah.
Mr. President, it's good to listen to you once again. I am glad that you spoke about the leadership library, the presidential library. And in the context of human security that you just spoke about, I'm wondering, with the chipmunk girls whom the world seems to have forgotten, and in the context of the international frameworks, particularly responsibility to protect, because as your role, part of your role as an eminent person is to advise the African Union. Within the context of responsibility to protect, the African Union adopted the Ezo-Winnie consensus. Can we not, as your brother Kofi Annan warned the world in 2004, that in the face of crises like Rwanda, the world can no longer fold their hands and invoke the theory of sovereignty. Can we not invoke as a winning consensus under the AU, as well as the responsibility to protect, to go into Nigeria to rescue?
Okay, all right. Okay, let's...
Excuse me.
I think that's it. Yeah. Okay. Right. Yeah.
Excuse me.
Please.
He's going to answer these,
and then
if we've got time, we'll come to you.
If you have time, I will come to you.
Yeah.
Please sit down.
Yeah.
Okay.
No. Okay. Mr. President.
Oh, do you want the
right,
soldier? Is that a Nigerian soldier?
No.
We'll have it in 1 minute. Okay. Yeah. Time. Okay, do you want to answer some of this?
Somebody asked about education and leadership. Mm. I have said, and I will say it again, I've said it often, a leader must be a reader. And there's no end to education. And any leader who ceases to be educated ceases to be a leader. It may be formal, informal, interaction. I take advantage of any opportunity and every opportunity to go to any conference because I see it as free education. In addition to the fact that I never stop to carry on and go on informal education. There's no substitute for education for a leader, formal and informal. Buhari supporting. Well, whatever you get in the paper and in the press, you please yourself. What I said, and I maintain that, and I will say it again, and I will do it. When the time comes for me to vote, I will consider the track record of all the candidates that are contesting. And I will assess, and based on my assessment for who I believe have the best of track record to perform the job of Nigerian president, then you will have my vote. And if anybody should know what the job of Nigerian president requires, I should know. And there's no sentiment in the affairs of Nigeria. And you ask me if I love Nigeria. So you love Nigeria. And you love Nigeria, you don't see beyond your nose.
Absolutely.
What nonsense. Look, Nigeria is a population of 180 million. And you won't have anybody other than one person or two persons that can run the affairs of Nigeria. What the hell are you talking about? For me, there are millions who can run the affairs of Nigeria who are not even coming out. Millions. So why should you die on behalf of one who is probably performing mediocre as a mediocre? With all due respect, Nigeria, if you love it, you will look for the best for Nigeria. And I don't believe that at this point in time we have the best for Nigeria. That's my own personal opinion. You may take it, you may leave it. You may curse me about it. You may praise me about it. That is my personal opinion, and I'm entitled to my personal opinion. You are entitled to yours. So if I have my personal opinion and you will insult me, then you are not a well-bred Nigerian. Because freedom, which we are all clamoring for, means that I see, and if you think that what I have seen is what you have seen it differently, come and say it. And if you convince me, I will be convinced. But you don't come to a place like this and come with preconceived idea and come with insult. Any Nigerian who is well born, well-bred, well-brought up, we respect two things, among others, age and authority. Let me finish before you clap. And I have them both.
So, President Obasanjo, remember your final question about the future of Nigeria, including health.
Now,
I haven't got time.
Love for Nigeria. I have said, if you love Nigeria more than I do, good luck to you. And good luck to good luck. Somebody asked what happened to Don Duke. Don Duke contested. And if you read my book, you will see the process. Now, he didn't make it. So you want me to say, all right, he didn't make it, then here. And I've said in that in my book too. At that time, I do not believe Nigeria is ready for a southerner to finish his two terms and to be succeeded by another southerner. We will get there. We will get there, but we are not there yet. Now, role for me to play in the ensuing thing. Why should you create crisis and then look for somebody to come and play a role? Why? The job of anybody who is elected in Nigeria as a leader is not to create crisis. Or the job of anybody who wants to be a Nigerian leader and wants the Nigerians to vote for him is not to create crisis. So if when you create crisis, you will look for an Obasanjo to come and settle it for you. Now, let me say this. Future of Nigeria, including health.
I want you to answer just quickly on the Chibok girls.
Okay, Chibok girls.
Yeah, and then the future of Nigeria, and then that's it.
Let me talk about Chibok girls.
Yeah.
The Chibok girls thing is an unfortunate issue. People have asked me, if you were in position, what would you have done? And I said, look, the local, I invited one Philip Madu, the pastor in Chibok, is the chairman of Christian Association of Nigeria in Chibok. And I said, come and tell me what happened. And listen to what he said. 6:30 on that day, he got information from one of the people around that some people from neighboring village are coming to make trouble in Chibok that night. So he phoned the local government chairman. And the local government chairman then said, I have heard. And I have reported to the Joint Task Force and to the police. Then the people came at 11:15. And they came to take food. They raided the market and the stores and all that. But when the teachers from the girls' school ran away, the students were milling around. It was then that the attention of the Boko Haram boys, and then they said, look, what do we do? Obviously, they must have asked for from their headquarters or from their higher authority, who said, okay, pack the girls and come. That they were not, it was not their intention originally to carry the girls. Then they were from about midnight till 5 a.m. they were looking for vehicles to carry the girls. If they have come with the intention to carry the girls, they will have come with vehicles. All right. Now, the governor of the state must have had the report by whatever time in the morning. The president of Nigeria must have had the report by whatever time in the morning. No action was taken. In fact, for a long time, and even till today, some people are still doubting if some girls were really abducted. Can that be human? If it was your own children, will you feel that way? And as I said, today is Chibok. Tomorrow, it could be my village, or the president's village, or the village of any of you, those of you who come from villages. So we have to. And then now people say, well, 300 days and what will happen? Those girls, you can never have them together again. For decades to come, the story of Chibok girls will be filtering out. Either one of them will either come out after producing children and whatever, will tell her own story. But what is important is that we must not forget. Okay. Thank you. And then we must also make sure that it does not happen again. Mm-hmm. Now,
the future of Nigeria.
Yeah. Future of Nigeria to me is very, very rosy. Very rosy. Look, the type of problem we are going through now, this is not the first time we will go through it. During the time we were negotiating for our independence in the 50s, we didn't agree. The East wanted internal self-rule quickly. The West wanted it quickly. The North said it's not ready. So that's why we didn't have internal self-rule the same day. The East had it in 1957. The West had it in 57. The North had it in 59. We went through it. We agreed to have independence for the whole country in 1960. We had it. Then in 1963, census, we had problems. We weathered the storm. In 1964, we have election. And those of you who will remember in the West, they call it wetie. They take kerosene and petrol, put it on your house, on your body, and put fire. We had that. We went through it. We survived. The coup, we went through it. We survived. It snowballed into the civil war. We went through it. We survived. We went through even Abacha. Abacha. Now, the people don't know this, or they have forgotten. We are in a situation where we had five parties, and all the five parties endorsed and nominated Abacha as their candidate. So for an election, five parties, one candidate. So. Now, after that, we weathered it. As I always said, if anybody had been the one who came to Abacha and took his life, he wouldn't allow the rest of us to rest. Mm. See, I have done it for you. But God did it. God did it.
So the outlook
is even this one that we are in, God will do it. Whether you like it or I like it, whether you don't like it or I don't like it, God will do it for Nigeria.
Okay.
I always say God is a Nigerian. Look at what, look at what we have gone through.
Thank you.
And look at how we have emerged successfully out of it. So, we will emerge out of this, and Nigeria will go up and up, forward and forward.
Thank you, President Obasanjo. On a just 1 second, yeah. They're giving you a standing ovation. So, thank you very much, Mr. President Obasanjo. I apologize to those of you who couldn't ask your questions, but just to say, if you want your answers, you'll find them in the books, in the biographies, so do get those. Thank you very much.